My name is Alessandro De Luca. I'm teaching this course since quite a long time. Every year we make some changes, so I hope that you will enjoy this course. As you have seen, we have now its first attempt of having video recording of this course, so that later on you or other students may listen to these classes from home. So, just a summary of information on the course. This takes place during the next 12 weeks until just before Christmas. As I said, it's intended for students of the main two masters and also some students from our third master offered in English from our department. You earn 6 credits, and more or less you will spend together 49 hours of class time. We will visit together a couple of times our laboratory in the basement of this building, and then you need to study by yourself in order to pass this class. The hours are fixed, and you can find all information also on the web. So we will stay in this room, B2, on Monday and on Friday for 4 hours, 4 academic hours. So how do you get in contact with me? The main source is through email. I'm almost all the time at the department. My office hours are every Tuesday. My office is in the second floor, left wing, so side A of the building. And my hours for students are regularly on Tuesday between 12 and 1:30. Of course, if you cannot come at this time, you may contact me in advance by email, and we can arrange other times. And please check on my website my travel dates, which I update regularly. When I know that I will be off on those days, there will be no class, and there will be also no office hours for students. So independently of the fact that I'm
advising you, of course, these are planned well ahead in time, so there will be no surprise. I suggest to make use as soon as possible of these office hours, because my experience is that students tend to come and ask questions and clear doubts only very close to the final exams. And this is not the best time to do this. Rather, you should try at least to continuously follow the program, so listen to the lecture in classroom and looking at the video and material that you have on the website. And this is the address of this course, and study on the book. This is very important. Remember that I'm presenting part of the material. The whole material is covered fully in the book. So on the website in particular, you will find, and you find already now, PDF of my lectures, not the PowerPoint slides, so no animation. But you find also packed in zipped folders, also videos. You can find a whole bunch of previous exams, written exams. Some of them, most of them, I should say, contain also the solution, and on purpose I left other without a solution in order to let you exercise on this. These slides are already ready for use. Next to each file you will find the date, which is the latest update of that document. So you will find some files which dates back 2012 or 2013. Or, for instance, this introduction has been just uploaded, so it's tagged 28th of September 2014. Okay. So eventually I will make some changes. There's always place for modification, error checking, and addition. So you will find this as a lively site. So go there often and look for the latest version of the documents. At the end, you will have to register to the written part of these exams, and you do this through InfoStudent. This holds also for if there are any Erasmus students, they receive the same password and code, they can register exactly like other Sapienza students through InfoStudent. So, what are the prerequisites of this course? Very few, I would say. I made it on purpose as a self-contained course. Of course, it has some bias, which reflects also my background. But essentially, what you need to know to understand the things is a bit of kinematics, the kinematics that you learn in basic course of physics, and some general concept of automatic control, just because we will make often use of the concept of feedback, and feedback is a measurement of some quantities which is fed back to the input and compared to some reference behavior. You generate an error and you drive your system based on this error. So this basic concept is essentially what you need to know, and if you need know also some mathematics behind, this may be useful. But essentially you should be familiar with the concept of feedback, which is at the ground of automatic control schemes. What is the aim of this course? Well, at the end, you should be acquainted with tools that allow you to perform the kinematic analysis of robot manipulators, to plan motion, in particular trajectory, and we will see that this can be done in different spaces, the natural Cartesian space where all robotics task occurs, but also in a different space, which is the so-called configuration or joint space, which is exactly what you expect if you mimic the behavior of a robot manipulator with that of your human arm. So the joint space is the space of all the revolute joints, in the case of my arm, that allows to provide mobility to the end effector, which in this case is my hand. Okay? So you can plan trajectory directly in the Cartesian space or trajectory for each of the joints of the arm, which results, of course, in some motion at the Cartesian level. While understanding how to do this, of course, eventually you should be able to program these robots. Programming is not much different from what happens in other contexts of computer science, but there are some peculiarity, because here we have physical system that moves in the physical world. So there are data structures, there are algorithms that take into account this peculiarity. For instance, one of the basic data structures for robots are the use of frames. So Cartesian frames or generalized frames that allows to define the relative position of bodies, to define the way in which a body changes orientation over time, and things like that. So all the concepts that we will analyze can be translated into pieces of code. And it's not important at this level which kind of program language you're using. There are dedicated languages for industrial robots, and we will see one of them, the KRL language for the KUKA robots. But in fact, you can use C++ or Python or Java, MATLAB, whatever you wish just to understand the actual performance of the technique, tools, and algorithms that we will develop together. Okay? Actually, I suggest everybody to, as soon as possible, as soon as we will introduce some mathematical concept, to try it out, for instance, in MATLAB, which is the most simple things in order to do computations. You can find the kernel of a matrix. You can define a parameterized path and display it in 3D. Or you can interpolate a sequence of points in order to generate a trajectory. Or you can solve symbolically some nonlinear system of equation which characterize the so-called inverse kinematic problem of a robot, and so on and so on. You can do product of matrices, both numerically or in symbolic form. So all things that we will see together can be coded, and in fact has been coded already, in MATLAB or in any other program. Okay? So I suggest you warmly to do this as soon as possible, because only if you try out something of directly with your own experience, you will really learn what's going on. So, kinematics, trajectory planning, programming, and controlling the motion of robot manipulators. So there's a special word here, manipulators, not any robots. We will focus actually on what is the common standard in industry, but also for service robotics, which is an articulated arm with fixed base. So we are not dealing with mobile base robots, so robots on legs, on wheels, on tracks. This part is a different part, which is covered by another course, which is the course of Professor Oriolo, autonomous and mobile robotics. Okay, so there's a clear, if you want to distinguish the two parts, are fixed base manipulator arms versus mobile base wheeled or whatever robots. I must say that many techniques for analyzing and designing controllers or planning motion for these systems are very similar, but we found it very clear to make this separation. So this is why robot manipulators, and these robot manipulators were born actually for industrial application, but more and more are being used out of the factory floor, in particular at home or on the streets or underwater in hospital for surgery. There are many, many so-called service applications. So application of robotics where these robots are being used not in the traditional production line, manufacturing, and so on. So our techniques are rather independent of the application because we are dealing now with the basic for understanding how a robot moves, how we can plan motion that satisfies certain tasks, and this is independently of the specific task the robot needs to do. Nonetheless, we will present in the first few lectures a quite large panoramic overview of application, both in industry and in service domains of robots, so that you can have at least a feeling of where this robot can be used. And eventually, when you will be done with your courses, and you may launch a spin-off and have an idea of, you know, implementing some robotic solution for a problem that has not been tackled so far. You will see there's a whole bunch of problems, but there are still open domains to robotization. Here I have the textbook Robotics Modeling, Planning and Control. It's a book written by four authors. Bruno Siciliano, Lorenzo Sciavicco and Luigi Villani are colleagues of mine from the University of Naples. And Giuseppe Oriolo is my dear friend and colleague from here. So there is a lot of interaction with the authors of this book. And the notation and terminology is very, very similar to what you will find in my slides. So there are no apples and oranges. They are really in the same style. Okay, this book is in English. There is also an Italian edition. As a matter of fact, there's also a Chinese edition, and also a Russian edition, and a Greek edition. And it's one of the most used textbooks in robotics worldwide. So it's a privilege to have it written by Italian colleagues. So this book contains practically all what you need to know, complemented by the slides. Of course, I'm not following one-to-one. I'm adding things. Otherwise, I could just leave you with the book and provide only explanation when needed. Okay? So read the book and not only the slides. And study on the book and on the slides. As I mentioned, there are two other strictly related courses in your curriculum. Which are Robotics 2, which is the continuation of Robotics 1, as you can expect. And we will see at the end of this lecture just a brief overview of what is its content. It's a course which is taught during the second semester, still by myself, while the other strictly related course is the one of autonomous and mobile robotics, also in the second semester by Professor Oriolo. So, let's start with a couple of videos in order to understand what is the problem here. What are these robots? What should they do? And how do we program them to do something? And I'm using for these few slides some videos that you can download also from the KUKA Laboratories website. So I'm using this because they are very compact, little commercial, just the name at the beginning. And they, the nice thing is that they refer to a special robot arm, which is this KUKA. KUKA is a German manufacturer of robots. LBR is the German acronym for LWR, which means lightweight robot. LWR in German, LBR. And if you know German, this means Leichtbauroboter. So this is a very advanced, I should say the most advanced robot on the market. It's an industrial product, and we have in our lab one robot which is very similar to that. Actually, it's just the previous generation, intended only for a research market. They made at KUKA some modification, and they converted into an industrial product with enhanced reliability and things like that. Otherwise, the robot is exactly the same as the one that we have in our lab. So, this robot has 7 revolute joints, which means that you will see it in motion. It can move the structure, moving around single axis, which provide a rotation of the distal part with respect to the proximal part around an axis, and this axis change in space depending on what the previous joints are doing. So it's just the motion of my arms reproduced in a mechanical device. But you can single out 7 axes around which this manipulator can rotate. Now, you will see in this picture, just to before starting the video, this is a so-called teach box. It's one easy interface through which an end user can program in an elementary way motion. And you will see now this teaching some Cartesian poses for the end effector of this robot. The end effector here is represented by this stab, in particular the tip here. So there's nothing particular. Of course, this robot can mount a welding gun or a camera or another tool. Now, in these videos, there are no tools, just general principle. So the end effector is this point here. And you will see now that through the teach box, operator can command motion, moving the robot around the workspace and saving some special point. And in this way, he generates a skeleton of a motion program that later on he can launch and then execute starting from some home position. Now, one word which is important here is Cartesian pose. Do you know what a pose is? We intend by pose the combination of position and orientation. Okay? So in general, in order to characterize the position of a point in space, you need how many coordinates? 3 coordinates. X, Y, Z, or polar coordinates, or cylindrical coordinates. It's not important, but the quantity is important. 3. How many variables do you need to characterize the orientation of a body in space? Four. Your colleague said 4. Who said 4? Why 4?
We need height, as you said, x, y, z.
No, but x, y, z, forget about position. Suppose that you have an object floating in space, no matter where it is. And now you want to characterize its orientation. Only its orientation, if it's like this, but let's say that its center of mass is always in the same point. So it's not really moving, translating, but it's only changing the orientation. Now, how many variables do you need to characterize the fact that this book is looking at you, or is looking at me, or is doing like this, and so on? Well, that's a simple question. But you will see that we will handle about representation of orientation for many hours, I would say. Okay? In fact, the minimal representation is based on 3 quantities. And you can figure out, there are no unique representations. You can figure out this like with a pointing device. Suppose that you have a radar, and you want to point at some target. So you have an elevation, first angle, a rotation, and now you're pointing to this. And now suppose that you put a frame along the pointing direction. Now you can rotate this frame like this. These are a sequence of 3 angles that characterize uniquely the orientation, okay? So of this last frame. You can start with the frame which is here, with 3 axes, I would say. So elevation, rotation, and then final rotation along the pointing direction. This is one way to represent orientation. You will see that there are many, actually, 2 × 12 independent ways of defining orientation. But any of this is problematic because it fails to represent all possible orientation of a body. So this minimal representation have singularities. There's another mathematical object which is able to represent the orientation of a generic rigid body and has no singularity at all. So it's always well defined, and this is the so-called rotation matrix. It's a 3x3 matrix which can characterize any orientation without encountering any singularity of representation. But it's a heavier object, a matrix of 3x3 rather than some array of three angular variables. Okay? So the pose is characterized by the combination of position and orientation. Okay, so we will come back to this basic issue. So let's look at this video first, and then we will comment together. So I'm starting the video now. So teaching position. So the human operator will touch the pad, move, press buttons, and you see that pressing button, it moves the end effector left and right, up and down, and back and forth. And then pressing another button, it stores in memory some position, P1, then moves the robot again, and then stores a new position, P2, and finally a third position, P3. After that, he will press another button and launch the execution of this program, having specified, let's say, the speed, the average speed in motion between one point and the other, but starting from a home position. This is the home position, and then he will go through the point P1 and stop, and then the point P2 and stop, P3 and stop, and then we'll go back to the home position, and is ready to repeat this, I don't know, 10,000 times. It's not important. Okay? So, I mentioned that this is teaching Cartesian poses. You have seen only positions. What about the orientation? In this simple task, it's like not commanding any change of orientation. This end effector, this tool, is always pointing downward and not making any rotation. So it's like having constant orientation and moving in one position, second position, third position, and so on. Of course, I could stay in the same position with a different orientation. Actually, with infinite to the third possible different orientation, because there are three variables needed to describe all possible orientation. Okay, so this is just a special case. But as you can see, this video shows the most standard way of programming robots. You may wonder, where is the program? What is the language? I'm just doing something, moving it around, and then storing this position or poses or configuration, whatever, and then repeating. Well, that's a matter of fact. Most of the time, this is the way in which robots are programmed. Of course, underlying this human-robot interface, there is a code that you can enter, modify, change parameter, add the point, and do whatever you wish. But just to understand what is the basics. Now a question. When the user here presses a button and learns the point P1, what do you think it's going to be stored in the memory of the controller of this robot? The Cartesian position or the configuration of the arm that puts the end effector in that position? Your colleague says the second. How many agree with this? So configuration. So if he stores the configuration, means the single angles of the structure that puts the end effector there, it has to know where its end effector is, okay? Because when it later on, there will be some disturbance moving the robot from this place and it needs to go back there, so it may have to understand what is the Cartesian distance from that. So the mathematical tool for determining which is the position of the end effector, or more in general, the pose of the end effector, given a configuration of the arm is called direct kinematics of the manipulator. And this will be one of the first topics that we will address. Okay? So the direct kinematics, if I can now make a very simple drawing. Suppose that you have a planar robot in the plane x0, y0. And this planar robot is made up of three links connected by three joints. So for instance, I have one joint here, and then I have a first link, then a second joint, a second link, then a third joint, a third link, and here I have a very simple gripper that opens and closes. Okay? So I can imagine that there will be some rotation around this joint axis, some rotation around this second joint axis, and some rotation around this third joint axis. And by moving these three bodies in the plane, the end effector will move in a given workspace. Of course, we will not reach this point. Why? Because this is too far away, given the kinematic parameter of this robot. But essentially, computing in this case, let's say P as a function of Q, where Q is an array of three variables, namely this angle, and this angle, and F is a function which contains also the length of these links, at least. So computing the position in the plane and possibly also, let's say, the angular orientation alpha with respect to the x0 axis is a problem of direct kinematics. And we will see a systematic way for computing direct kinematics of any robot, as simple as this planar three revolute joints robot, as complex as this spatial seven revolute joint robots. Okay? Now you may wonder, suppose that you want to put the end effector of this robot here. So this is, let's say, P desired. Now, how can you solve this problem? Which configuration should the robot assume such that in that configuration the end effector is placed exactly at P desired? Here. Well, some guess on how many solutions are there to this problem. Well, in this particular case, there are infinite. Okay? But this depends also where I'm asking to place the end effector. If I'm asking this point, how many solutions are there? Zero. Can you imagine a situation where there's only one solution? So something in between zero and infinite. Okay, okay. So your colleague said when the sum of the link's length is equal to the distance, the point, the origin, and so on. So we say when the point is at the boundary of the working space, okay? Which in this case, if I say that these three links are L1, L2, and L3, and I straighten up the arm, so if the norm of the vector PD, the norm, so how big it is, from the origin, this is the origin, is equal to L1 plus L2 plus L3. So no matter, so in practice, on a circle of radius L1 plus L2 plus L3, then I have to stretch my arm, and I can reach this position only in one configuration, or in one configuration if it's here, or if it's here, and so on. So, even in this simple case, you see that You have no solution, one solution, infinite solution. There are also cases where you have a finite number of different solutions. It's a mess. In fact, this problem is called inverse kinematic problem of the manipulator. And we will see as next topic, we will tackle this problem, which is a nonlinear problem and as such escapes from simple solution. But we will see that there are methods in order to find one, many, infinite solution to this problem. Okay? Either analytically or in numerical form. And for a numerical method, we need to do some iteration. We have to solve a system of nonlinear equation by resorting to some numerical method. And if you've heard about, those methods have the name of gradient method or Newton method or things like that. They are nothing special, only applied to this special problem in robotics. Okay, so direct and inverse kinematics only on one video. Let's move on. We have seen some simple programming and made some comment on this. Sorry. Okay, now suppose these robots are not just used to go from one place to the other, although this is one of the most common elementary tasks. For instance, I'm here, I'm the robot, I need to take your smartphone from here, take it to this place, go over some obstacle here, and go down and leave it to this place. And then take it again and bring it there. So this is a very common pick and place operation. Okay? But this is not the whole story. There are other tasks which involves continuous motion, following trajectories. In particular, if you have to glue together two parts, you have the two metallic parts placed somewhere in the workspace of the robot, and the tool of the robot is a gluer that needs to follow some path with a given speed, so it needs to execute some trajectory. Not too fast, otherwise you don't have time to put enough glue. Not too slow, otherwise it's better to use a human to do this. It's not cost effective. Okay, so we use typically in industrial setting robots because they are fast, accurate, they are highly repetitive. Okay, they work on three shifts of 8 hours per day, and so on and so on. Okay, so there are also tasks which involves trajectories. Now look what this robot can do once you have learned some initial point on the plane and some final point on the plane, and you have specified a way for going from one point to the other, on and on. By the way, this trajectory is in contact with the surface. But because of some control compliance, and we will see what this means, it is able also to adapt without any change of the original program to uncertain environments. So this is the nominal plan. It goes up and down, or left and right, on the surface. Now the surface has some uncertainty, pretty high, so it's just continue to follow the same surface, even if it's undulated. And this is thanks to the way in which the robot is controlled. In practice, you specify a stiffness, or its inverse, a compliance with respect to the nominal desired position. So you specify in your program how much you can give away from the original target. Okay? And in fact, you would like not to give away because you want to be very precise. But you can do this only if you know exactly your environment. As soon as you have some uncertainty, then you need to do something, otherwise you crash either the environment or the very precious tool that the robot may hold in its hand. Okay? So you need to include compliance. And this compliance can be programmed. And this is the nice thing. And can be very easily programmed in this robot. So here I have two videos. I'm waiting for, okay. So two videos which shows how you can program, pay attention, not motion, but robot compliance. So in association with a planned motion or a planned behavior, even just stay at some fixed point or move along a given path, and then you can specify how rigid, how stiff should the robot behave with respect to error, with respect to the nominal path. And so you specify this in different way along different direction. So let's start with the top video. So programmable compliance for positioning. Here there is no trajectory. The robot should stay with its end effector in this position, and the human applies forces, and the robot reacts by giving away the position or being more stiff depending on the programmed compliance. And this compliance may be on positional parts. Here you don't see the numbers, but in this case the compliance is much lower, so you can move away from the desired position the robot. And here you have a selective compliance. So in this direction it's very hard to move the robot. In other direction it's very soft, and in the last direction is even softer. Okay? So this is a way in which you program the robot. So it's not intrinsic in the robot itself. It's not a mechanical aspect. It's just a software. So you specify a smart way for the robot to behave by changing some proper parameter. In this case, we are changing the stiffness in the x, y, and z direction of the Cartesian plane. So we need to know how do we compute this and how we are able to impose this stiffness by moving only the joints. Remember, there is no motor moving the end effector. The end effector is moving only because we are moving the joints. So we have a continuous passage between the joint space where the motors are placed and the Cartesian space where we would like the task to behave in a desired way. So this is a continuous problem, back and forth between the joint space and the Cartesian space, or more in general, what we will call later on, and this will be clearer, the so-called task space, which is a generalization of the Cartesian space, for instance, including also orientation. The second video at the bottom should show, if I remember well, some behavior, some compliant behavior, selective not only in linear direction, but in angular behavior. So you can be very stiff with respect to linear motion, so that if the human pushes with force in various directions, the end effector doesn't move, but you can program a very compliant behavior with respect to change of orientation. So you can change the orientation while keeping the position in place very easily, or vice versa. Okay? So this is what should be shown in this second video, if I remember correctly. So these are examples of program compliance. So here you can move in XY, but it never change orientation. And now you flip. So here you can change orientation, but the end effector remains always in position. Okay, very easy. Now you should be able to describe orientational motion, like translational motion, not only position and orientation, but linear velocity and angular velocity, what is called the differential kinematics. You should be able to describe also the mapping between forces applied to different points of the robot, in particular at the end effector, and the resulting torques at the joints, which will move the configuration of the robot or not. So all this mapping has to be described, analyzed, and at the end you should be master of this subject so that you can program such behavior. So, and now let's go back to programming motion. Now that we have seen that we can modify the compliance of the robot and that the human can do something which up to a few years ago, I would say 4 or 5 years ago, was considered to be impossible in an industrial setting. Namely, an operator entering the workspace of a robot and touching it physically while the robot is active. This was considered to be very unsafe, very risky. There are regulations which prevents user from doing so. There are cages. There are sensors delimiting the area of operation of the robot such that if I enter this area, the robot stops and the power is taken out of the motor so that the system is completely at rest, which is fine for conventional automation. But if we want to have these robots entering our houses and help us in doing daily activities, holding things, or doing some elementary task at home, like painting or doing something, then we should be assured that these systems are safe, that this system recognizes that there is a contact, and are sufficiently lightweight. This is why they have produced this robot. We will go back to the masses involved in this structure later on. So the whole idea is to have a safe, the possibility of implementing safe physical human-robot interaction. In other courses in this master, like the AI courses or vision and perception of the master in AI and robotics, you will be faced with the issue of cognitive interaction. How do I speak to a robot? How do I understand? How does the robot understand what I want to do? And so on and so on. Very interesting, but here we focus on the physical interaction. So contact, exchange of forces. Okay? You can dispute with a robot verbally. It's not a problem. It's much more problematic if you want to do it physically. Okay? So, this idea of having compliant robots and lightweight structures actually allows to use this feature also for programming motion. So, to go back to the roots and have the human just move around the robot instead of using this not very friendly human-robot interface, this teach box with buttons and things like that. So the idea here originally is in this sketch. So what could we do with this feature of compliance? So we could go to the robot and start moving around the robot and then bring it to one position, store it, do everything like we used to do with the teach box, but physically moving around the system. And then once this has been learned, it can be repeated exactly in the way we would like to have. So this was the concept. Now it took a lot of time in order to be able on an industrial robot to do such type of behavior. And this is the final current solution. So pay attention. Now there's an extra button on the end effector so that you can teach by demonstration. So you go there, you press the block, you have a green light here, and now you can move around the robot, and you have another button to press to store a position, exactly like we did before, but now moving this around. Why? Because there is a programmable compliance. In the teaching phase, the robot is very compliant in any direction so that you can move it around. And then in the execution phase, it may become very stiff so that it reproduces exactly the plan program. And here you can see a typical pick and place and actually insertion of a peg in a hole. And the 6 points that you learned in this way, we will remember this picture because this is a typical 4-3-4 trajectory where you have a starting point, a detached point, some safe point in between, an approach point, and a final point where you complete the task. And you can then program some smooth motion around this. But in this case, it just goes through the points. And by the way, you have seen that it stops at every learned position. You may think this is useless. I want to stop only at the beginning and at the end. I want to go through this point with non-zero velocity so that I can speed up motion. This is possible. And this is part of how to program trajectories, in this case, in the Cartesian space for the robot. Okay, so I'm highlighting several aspects of our program through this video. And if you're interested, you can find this and other videos in the YouTube channel of the KUKA laboratories. I'm not paid by KUKA. Okay. So it's just that I believe they are good robots. Okay, so with this in mind, we are very slow, I must say, but good. I hope that you start having a flavor of what we are going to do. So let's go through some details of the program. So we will start with some introduction on manipulator arms. Few mobile robots, just to have in mind that there are also mobile-based. And of course, you may have also so-called mobile manipulator, so a fixed base manipulator like an arm mounted on a mobile platform, and so you have the best of both worlds, so something that could walk around or move around this department, maybe go up and down the stairs if it's tracked, and then do manipulation with the arm on board. Okay, so it's, and then we will, as I anticipated, we will go through a number of industrial uses of these robot manipulators and a large variety of service application. And when we will go through this, we will use many videos. It's not important that a single video, just to give you ideas. And I hope that we will have some interaction on this. If you like this application, you don't like them. If you think that they are worth investigating more or less, and so on and so on. Then we will study the anatomy of a robot manipulator. What are the essential components? And there is a mechanical structure, of course. But then what really characterizes a robot are actuators, motors, most of the time electrical motors. But for very heavy lift, for robots that have to move around 2,000 kilograms of payloads, electrical motors are not appropriate. They tend to burn when they sustain continuously heavy payloads under gravity. So you prefer to use hydraulic actuation or pneumatic actuation. So we'll just have a few ideas on these components, and then the huge variety of sensors that this robot have. Actually, the presence of sensing is what characterized the new generation of robot with respect to the previous one. The previous one were blind, dumb, whatever. They could not see, they could not hear, they could not feel, like the Tommy of the famous Who album many years ago. I don't know if you know it. But anyway, now sensor. We will see a huge number of sensors. They are classified into groups, so-called proprioceptive sensors. This is a terminology inherited from the human, so it's bio-inspired, if you want to use a very trendy term. So proprioceptive are sensors which are able to understand what is the internal configuration of the system. If I have my joint stretched or folded, if I have some velocity at the joint, high or low, and so on. Mainly here I'm quoting some typical proprioceptive sensor, encoders for position measurement at the joint, or tachometers for velocity measurement. And then there's a huge number of exteroceptive sensors, so sensors that allows the robot to know about its environment. And if the robot knows about its environment and you add some quote-unquote intelligence to the robot, he can do this link between sensing and acting in the right way in order to perform generic tasks. And the more sensor you use, the more expensive is your robot, of course, but the more flexible is in its use. So you don't have to set up all its environment in order to do exactly and many, many times and very fast this task, but you can rely on the sensing information in order to correct small uncertainty or disturbances or whatever is acting on the robot itself. And among the class of sensor, there are multiple types. Force torques need contact at the end effector. Tactile are, again, contact sensor, but very elementary. They mimic the behavior of our skin. And then there are proximity sensors, so that don't need contact, but are able to estimate distances to obstacles or to humans in the environment. So ultrasonic sensor, infrared, laser. And then there's a prince of all sensors, vision. Vision has a lot of information, probably too much information for a robot. Why? Because this sensor needs to be used in real time. So they need to provide information to the robot in order to act immediately. If I have an image, and in order to understand what is in the image, I take 3 seconds, this is too long a time in order to command the motion. In 3 seconds, things are already changed. Okay? So the main difference between a course on vision in general, which is wonderful, and robot vision, is the time lapse between grabbing of a frame, processing, and having an idea of what to do. So better poor but fast information rather than complete understanding of what's going on. So this is why in robotics we tend to use few features extracted from the environment and drive the robot motion from this. Okay, so this is just to say that having a very powerful sensor is not the solution of all problems. It may introduce more problems than using a simpler sensor. Okay? So these are the components that we will study, and then we will study, I must say, in parallel, so we will progress on components, and which is most descriptive in a sense. And in parallel, I will present kinematic models, which is more mathematics, okay, so that we have a blend of everything. So we will go through minimal representation of position, but this is trivial, of orientation, we will spend a lot of time there, and then, as I introduced, we will deal with direct and inverse kinematics and how to solve this problem, and then we will move to motion, so-called differential kinematics, so the mapping between, let's say, velocity of the joints and the velocity, linear and angular, of the end effector. And of course, as for the previous mapping, you have also the inverse differential mapping. If I want to achieve a velocity in that direction, how should I move my joints? Okay? And this is the inverse differential kinematics. And for solving this problem, we will introduce a concept which is very central, which is the so-called Jacobian associated to the robot. Finally, we have seen forces applied to the structure, and we would like to see how these forces map from one space to the other, so from the Cartesian space or from the generic surface of the robot into torques at the joint level that the motor should balance in a static situation. And all this transformation will include a major problem for robots, which are singularities. So situation where apparently the behavior is no longer smooth, but all of a sudden, while commanding a very small motion in the Cartesian space, you will see the arm doing a flip of 180 degrees in half a second. Why is that? Because you get closer to a singularity and your control was not taking care of this. So this is a basic question for all robots, especially in industry. The programming of tasks in industry, of very complex tasks, is very much delayed by the fact that the user needs to avoid this singular situation. So understanding where are the singularity for a given robot and how to avoid or compensate for the singularity is another important task of this course. And finally, the second part will be devoted to planning motion trajectories, and we have seen some example point-to-point task, continuous motion along a path, linear path, circle, or sequence of points to be interpolated. And this can be done either in the joint space, where the result is much simpler, although you lose visibility of what the end effector is doing actually in the at the end effector level, or directly in the Cartesian space. But then you have to transform this desired motion into some motion of the joints, because at the joints level is where the robot is actuated with the motors. Okay, again, this problem of transforming back and forth condition and information. And finally, control. What's the difference between planning and control? Planning is made on a nominal word. So if everything is where I expect to be, I should do this and this and this. I can avoid obstacle, I can go as fast as possible to a certain place, and so on and so on. What if there are some disturbances? What if there are uncertainties? So you need to use your sensor and compensate for this deviation. This is what is feedback control all about. Okay? And we will see some simple, what is the control system architecture of typical industrial robot, and we will see some simple kinematic control law, and then including some early concept of dynamics, also some independent joint axis control law. This is more technical, we will see later on. To complete the program, programming and simulation. So we will go through what are the characteristics, the generic characteristics of programming languages for industrial robots. In particular, we will study the set of commands and data structure of KRL, which is one of the KUKA robot language. But we will use MATLAB and Simulink for, you will use MATLAB and Simulink for doing computation and simulating planners and controllers. And if you want to have a nice graphical interface and a simulation with these nice robots that move, including the KUKA robot arms, you may use the open source software, which is VREP. How many of you have heard about MATLAB, Simulink, and VREP? None. How many knows MATLAB? Okay, good. Simulink. Simulink is a toolbox of MATLAB in order to do in an easy way with an icon interface simulation of dynamic system. How many of you have heard about VREP? One person, two person, okay. So just Google this and look what they are. In particular, you can download the open source of VREP and start playing around. VREP is only for rendering. Pay attention, you can program inside VREP, or you can program some motion in MATLAB and then output the variables that you need, and you use the CAD models that you have generated or have available in the libraries of VREP and animate the robot so that you can see not ugly drawings like this on the plane, but you can see a three-dimensional robot moving in 3D, and this is more, lets you understand more what's going on, okay? So this is the use of that. And finally, there will be some demos of our research activities in the lab, and we have two robots there, two KUKAs, actually an industrial, a small size industrial KR5 with 6 degrees of freedom, and then we have the previous version of the LBR IVA, which is the LBR 4 Plus, which is as the other robot, a 7 degrees of freedom robot. Well, I think that I stop now.